This is John Colin with growingyourgreens.com. A little bit of hoarse voice here. I've been giving some lectures over the last couple days, talked to over 100 people at two different talks, had an amazing time, but my voice is a little bit trashed. Nonetheless, glad I could have another episode for you guys, and what we're going to do today is answer your guys' questions. So oftentimes when I get questions over YouTube's email system or actually on my channel page, they may end up actually in a question and answer session like this. So if you want your question submitted to a question and answer session like this, email it to me and it may appear in a session like this, or actually you may not get a response at all. I apologize, I can't respond to every possible inquiry or else I'd have a second full-time job just answering gardening questions all day, and I'm not currently doing that for a living, maybe one day. If you do post the question below the video, you have the probably largest possibility of me answering it, or actually somebody else answering it, one of my other viewers answering it. But I can't get to every possible question, although I do read most of them. So once again, let's go ahead and get into these questions. So the first question we're going to get into is from R3 Ball. Hey John, since your show is about edibles and medicinal plants, would you consider visiting a medicinal marijuana growing op or co-op to talk to them about how they grow their plants? I think it would be fascinating. Yes, absolutely. I'm a big advocate of growing hemp, which is the industrial hemp, which is not any, does not have like the medicinal properties of the cannabis style hemp. There are two different like varieties, although they look the same, they're different. And I believe that that is an amazing herb. I mean, literally it's an herb, just like this basil is sitting here growing next to me. It's an amazing herb that we can use. And if you don't smoke it and you eat it and you juice it, there's many medicinal properties that you can derived from that we can't get from them because we're not allowed to grow them by law without a permit, you know, or medical card, depending on your state. I know in California you can get a medical card and grow your own. And the day it becomes legal, I will be growing it. But yes, if you do have any co-ops in the area or anything, places that would like to have me, you know, shoot me an email, let me know about them. And if I'm in the area, I'll be sure to get by there and actually make a fabulous video to educate more people about the power of these wonderful plant foods, whether they're the ones that are, you know, right now illegal to grow, or whether they're the legal ones like basils and some of the other crops, you know, that I educate you guys about. Okay, so the next question is from Glum Glum. Hi, John. I started a small garden, and I'm unsure what to plant. This month is June. You could tell I'm a little bit behind on answering my questions here. And summer heat is about to start. Can you give us what kind of plants and vegetables are good to grow during this month? I did start planting tomatoes and onion. So basically, Glum Glum, the thing I'm going to recommend, because I don't even know where you live, I mean, every location is a little bit different. You know, if you live in the Pacific Northwest or San Francisco, I mean, it's pretty cool even in the summertime. So you could get by with planting certain crops. But if you plant like a, you know, a variety of tomato that likes the heat in the summertime in San Francisco, it's not going to do well. You know, if you are in Las Vegas, for example, and you try to plant some lettuce in the middle of summer, guess what? Not going to do too well. Gets way too hot here. I mean, last week it hit like 114 degrees. But as you can see, my garden is absolutely thriving. So, you know, there's specific things that you should be and should not be planting. Now, what are they? Well, you know what? I would actually defer the question to experts in your area. You should look towards university extension programs that teach gardening. You should also reach out to other farmers and other growers in your area, other gardeners, and ask them, hey, what can I plant at this time? Because they are truly the experts. I could tell you what I would probably grow if I knew the location, but I don't. So, you know, go around to people in your area that know what they're doing, that have been doing it a long time, have been getting successful results, and then you're gonna find out what grows well at that time. Another thing you can do, although this is not 100% foolproof, is go to a local nursery, not a big box store, not a Home Depot, not a Lowe's, but to a local nursery, independently owned and operated. In most cases, the local nurseries are gonna sell the plants that you could plant right now. They're not gonna sell plants that you have to wait, you know, in general, and also talk to them about it. Hey, what can I plant right now that's edible? I'm sure they'll hook you up with a whole bunch of plants. I also want to encourage all you guys to support local businesses whenever possible. Next question is from, I'm going to have a problem pronouncing this one, Cinquencinito Nero. Hi, John. I planted a garden this year because you inspired me. Great. My question is, why did all my broccoli bolt? And what should I do now? Pull it and grow something else next year. I live in Connecticut and the weather has been cool this year so far. So the big question is, why did the broccoli bolt? Well, I just actually saw Sylvia Brown, the famed psychic, and you know, I I didn't get a chance to ask her that question for you so she could tell me why your broccoli bolted, and I'm not there to see. But in general, broccoli bolts for a few reasons. The number one reason why it bolts is due to the weather, you know, or climatic conditions. So maybe the weather was nice and cool, it got hot for a day, then it was cool again. This really kind of messes up the plants. Like if we go to Antarctica and back to hot Las Vegas, our system's gonna kind of be mumbled jumbled, you know? Most people, if you're like me, I kind of like to tend to like the warmer weather, but there's some people that just like the cold weather. They don't like when it's too hot. You know, I kind of like hot, but not too hot. And you know, plants are kind of like the same way. They're very temperamental. Some plants like it really warm, tomatoes and things, and some plants like it a little bit cooler, but we'll deal with some heat sometimes if it doesn't get too extreme. So, you know, your broccoli may have bolted because of the funky weather, but another thing it could be bolting from is from stress. So stress could be caused by the weather or by underwatering, overwatering, or uneven watering. Stress could be caused by poor soil. There's so many different things that could cause your broccoli to bolt, and once again, I'm not there to see and know all the specifics about your situation, so I don't know. So it's one or a combination of those basic things that cause your broccoli to bolt. Now, when your broccoli bolts, don't worry about it. Just, you know, start cut them off. You might not get that big, huge broccoli head that you're used to buying in the grocery store, but you know what? That's just a small portion of the broccoli that's edible. The broccoli plant along its whole life cycle is absolutely edible and delicious. When you take broccoli seeds, you grow them in their little sprouts. You could eat the broccoli sprouts, and they found that the broccoli sprouts fight things like cancer, things like that. Once it gets a little bit bigger, you could harvest the broccoli greens. Broccoli greens could be used like my tree collard greens here. Eat them raw, juice them up, you know, steam them up if you prefer. But they could be eaten raw at any stage. Once they start going to and forming the little flower heads, even if they're really small and not the big bunch, you could just pick those off, and I like to dip them in some dressing and eat them right up. You could also juice them or blend them as well. You know, once that gets a little bit longer and the stalk gets bigger, I like to harvest the nice, rich, juicy stalk before it gets bolting too much. And then I'll shave off the outside skin covering, and I'll just eat the stalk. And eating the broccoli stalk is like eating maybe some jicama. That's the closest vegetable that I can relate to. It's really like eating kohlrabi, if you've ever had kohlrabi, because that is just the elongated stalk on a brassica plant. But it's amazing if you peel it. I love eating the inside, just slice it into chips, dip it in a dressing, and eat it right up. Oh, that's one of my favorite delicacies, actually, the broccoli and other cruciferous stalks like the cauliflower as well. Once it starts going to bolt really bad, you know, you could save a few plants for seeds, so you could have seeds for next year. The other thing you could do is, you know, you could continue to eat it, even though it's, you know, has a little bolt and like the broccoli, like that looks like the store. If it has the, yellow flowers coming out, pick those flowers and eat them too. The flowers are actually rich in the pollen, which is rich in the proteins and amino acids, and also the pigments. It's nice yellow pigment, probably has some good lutein and zeaxanthin, good for your eyes or something. I mean, at all points, the broccoli plant's edible. Now, when the plant gets really old and woody and stuff, especially if you're not watering well, I mean, it's still edible, but I probably wouldn't recommend you guys eating it. So yeah, so now that your broccoli's done, hopefully you now know how to use all of it, even if it is bolting. You could eat it all. Most of the time, I like to actually juice with it, and I do have a good episode on YouTube where I show how to use your bolting greens, which is mainly by juicing and juicing the flower tops and the tops and everything and getting maximum utilization out of them. But once it does bolt, don't wait for the next season. Start planting today. You know, as soon as something comes out, I usually enrich my soil and plant something else. And actually this time I'm gonna be replanting the bed over there with some more pepper plants. So yeah, you always wanna continually try to grow stuff, because the worst thing that's gonna happen when you try to grow something, if it doesn't grow, you've lost the plant. No big deal. But if it does grow, you're gonna grow food for you and your family, which is one of the most important things you could do. So hopefully that helps you out there. Actually, we're down to the last question. Last question is from V. Morgum. Thank you for your videos, very informative. Thanks to your channel, I learned about new plants and have more diversity in my garden. I hear lots of positive things about prickly pear cactus, edible cactus. My reasoning, cactus is a tough plant to kill and might be relatively low maintenance. Do you have any experience with edible cactus plants? I just bought some from a local Mexican grocery store. I hope some root and will develop soon. Absolutely. So actually, I know you probably can't see it over there, but I have one cactus pad. I just put in a pot, and I'm really neglecting it, watering it once in a while when I remember. But those things are quite hardy, and actually they're an amazing food. The part of the cactus that I like the most is actually the fruits. The fruit's really high in antioxidants, nice, dark, rich pigments. They've done a lot of research that has shown it can help with some health conditions that people might have, common health conditions. And also the pads are very usable. So I'd encourage you guys to grow the spineless variety. The spine variety can be good and can have other uses, but it's also a pain to cut all the spines off before you eat it. And the pads themselves are the leaves of the plant, nice, rich, and succulent, and can be eaten. You know, just cut off all the prickers, and you could just dice it up and put a little bit of it in a salad. So yeah, cactus, definitely a really good food. And besides just the standard Nopalus prickly pear cactus, there's other cactus varieties that produce edible fruit and, you know, have edible pads. But be sure to research that, because I'm not by any means expert in growing cactus. I just have one grown and have grown them in the past, and I enjoy and eat them every so often in my own personal life. So yes, go for it. You know, they're fairly slow growers, and if you do get the ones with the stickers, then you could actually grow them on the outside of your yard, around the perimeter, or near a window, you know, to keep burglars away and keep animals out. I mean, that's why the plants have them. Plants have natural defenses so that they won't get eaten. So yes, cactus pears and prickly pears, Nopalus, definitely encourage you guys to grow them. So hopefully you guys enjoyed this quick question and answer session. If you have any further questions, once again, post them down the video for my personal response sometimes, or put them on my channel page or email them over YouTube, and they actually may end up in a video like this. So once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and remember, keep on growing.